The word ekphrasis comes from the Greek for the description of a work of art produced as a rhetorical exercise. It is a vivid, often dramatic, verbal description of a visual art piece.
This is Darwin Messidou. Welcome to the Ekphrastic, a podcast where we paint pictures with words. Today's subject, Leonardo da Vinci. The polymath in painting, drawing, sculpting, science engineering, architecture, even anatomy. All that to come later. But first, let's get into some art news. Frank Bolin was knighted by the Queen, y'all. Queen of England. As he enjoys his late career rise to widespread fame, artist Frank Bolin has been knighted by the Queen as part of her birthday honors list, which is given out twice annually, once on New Year's Eve and once on the Queen's birthday. Bolin had already been named an officer of the Order of the British Empire, and the knighthood is yet another symbol of his growing status within the British art world. I'm going to have to feature this guy. This brother some point in the near future. I'm going to put a pin in that one. The remainder of Queen's birthday honors list for this year will be revealed on Saturday. Few Black British artists have been named knights. For some, the designation has been a fraught one. In 2003, the poet Benjamin Zephaniah famously rejected the award because of the years of brutality associated with the word, quote, empire, quote unquote, which he said implicitly can be linked to slavery and colonialism. Attitudes have begun to change, however. In 2019, artist and filmmaker Steve McQueen accepted the knighthood. He said, because I'm from here, and if they want to give me an award, I'll have it. Thank you very much. Bolin, who was born in Guyana, and is based in London and New York, had a similar reaction to McQueen. In a statement, he said, trained in the English art school tradition, my identity as a British artist has always been crucial to me, and I have viewed London as my home since 1953. Since then, British Guyana, to be recognized for my contribution to British painting and art history with a knighthood, it makes me extremely proud. So, he'll take it. Semi-abstract paintings, drawings on his own biography, and various histories of colonialism has been exhibited often in recent years, having made the jump from figuration to abstraction in the 1960s. He has been embraced as a pioneer for his process-based abstractions, which obliquely pay homage to forced migration and exodus without explicitly representing them. His work appeared in The Traveling Survey, Soul of a Nation, Art in the Age of Black Power in 1963 through 1983, which first opened at Tate Modern in London in 2017. Tate organized its own Bolin Survey in 2019. Earlier this week, he joined the roster of one of the world's biggest galleries, Hozier & Worth. So congratulations to Mr. Frank Bolin. Like I said, I'm definitely going to have to check him out in a future episode. Okay, yeah, guys, so we talked about this a couple months back, a couple episodes back, and what's happening here is Palm Springs Art Museum, they're going to do some de-ascension, $2.5 million piece from Helen Frankenthaler at Sotheby's. They're being sold there. So yet another American museum has announced a move to de-ascension, a major work from its permanent collection. We talked about this, and what I was saying is that a lot of these museums are going to have to start doing, a lot of these art galleries are going to have to do this. They have these things in storage, just collecting dust, and the prices and the worth of some of these, these portraits, these sculptures, all these pieces that they have in storage, it's all theoretical, really, what they're worth, but when you put it out for, when you put it on the auction block, we can really see what some of this stuff is really worth. And so this piece is called Carousel by Helen Frankenthaler, and it's estimated to go for about 2.5 to 3.5 million. We'll see if it gets that much, but I mean, it's a double-edged sword here. You in the age of Rona, you don't have as many patrons coming into your galleries, but and you need the money, and now you have all these pieces in your collection. Maybe you bring out once every 3 years, just do a quick exhibition, and mostly they're just collecting dust in storage. You know, you're paying folks to maintain this work. These curators are you know, they got to get paid too. So, you know, what are you gonna do? You need to make some money. And but again, now you're risking flooding the art market. So you flood the art market is if more institutions start doing this or taking advantage of the relaxed rules, the price of art goes down. And I can't be having the price of art go down just when Black folks are starting to get into these spaces and starting to really make income and build a legacy off of their work. So, double-edged sword, like I said. So, in a release, the museum said that the decision to sell the Frankenthaler, a large canvas filled with overlaid red brushstrokes and color fields, comes after a recent review of its permanent collection this summer, which was conducted as part of a years-long initiative to diversify and expand its holdings. Funds from the sale will be put in a restricted account and will be used for both collection maintenance and future acquisitions. In keeping with newly relaxed guidelines with the Association of Art Museum Directors, a key industry group. The museum said future deaccessions will be made, but did not further detail its financial plans for the fund. I love the way they snuck that whole expand its holdings language in there. You know, what's happening is that it's a move to diversify. You know, a lot of these institutions are feeling that pressure, about time, really, to diversify their holdings, and not only their holdings, but their staff, the communities that they're in, the outreach that they perform, you know, these exhibitions. It sometimes can feel like a bit of affirmative action. I know that's a loaded term there, but hey, I'll take it. You know, I'll take it. It's a tangible difference. One step at a time. We'll take it as a tangible difference. And when these diversification movements happen more and more, and it can perhaps then become part of the institutional DNA. And that's what I really am looking forward to. But in the meanwhile, all right, you want to make this move to diversify, and you know, you have things like Oscar So White trending. You don't want to be like, oh, the Met is so white, you know, and Sotheby's is so white, you know, and they're not auctioning off, or they're not displaying Black art and these things. So fine. In the meanwhile, we'll keep pushing. So this is a huge canvas. This thing measures 7 feet high and 17 feet wide. Would look great in my living room. But I'm just short of the 2.5 mil. Anyways, so the carousel has been in the museum's collection for almost three decades. Three decades collecting dust. Man. It is one of 132 works donated by philanthropist and interior designer Steve Chase. Upon his death in 1994, alongside other works from his collection by David Hockney, Ellsworth Kelly, Ed Rocha, Sam Francis, Nathan Oliveira, he also gifted a 1.5 million gallery wing named for him in 1996. The work is one of only two Frankenthaler's works dated from the 1960s, 1970s in the museum's holdings. So there you have it. It's happening, y'all. It's happening. So get your checkbook out. You know, maybe you want to put a bid on one of these puppies. Just keep an eye out. Because more and more of these galleries are going to be dusting off some of these classic works that, you know, and if anything, at least people get to see them now, right? Instead of just again, being in storage. So looking forward to you know, what the next shoe to drop on this deascension thing. So we'll follow up on it again in the future. And for our main piece today, we have something from Art in America. So Rosa Rodriguez Williams has just been appointed, and she's got a new job at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston as the Senior Director of Belonging and Inclusion. Oh, yeah, just got this. About time. Following a racial incident in the spring of 2019, yeah, that's usually how it happens. The museum launched a fund for diversity and inclusion initiatives. Rodriguez Williams, who previously helmed the Latinx Student Cultural Center at Northeastern University, she discusses here in this article working with staff and engaging historically underrepresented audiences and some related topics. And again, I remind you, this is Boston. So, good luck, Rosa. I wish you the best. I'm doing a lot of listening in my new position. So far, I've been learning as much as I can about the museum and those who work here. I am prioritizing visitor experience by working alongside colleagues on everything from exhibitions to learning programs to cultivate a sense of belonging. I want everyone who visits the MFA Boston to feel seen, valued, and respected. I've always been very interested in this kind of work. I've had about 20 years of experience creating inclusive spaces for people of marginalized identities and backgrounds, but I'm really excited to foster inclusion in this space and in this time, which are so fraught with conflict and division. I'm currently leading the voluntary group Inclusion, Diversity, Equity, and Accessibility. Whoa, that's a lot. Okay, so there's an acronym. It's IDEA. I-D-E-A. Inclusion, Diversity, Equity, and Accessibility. Well played. So she's leading this voluntary group where museum staff discuss issues of inclusion, diversity, and access. We're working on forming affinity groups where we can all come together to learn from each other. So she goes on. During one of my first days at the MFA Boston, a colleague of mine took me on a walk in the art of the American Wing. I found it so incredibly moving to see works from different historical time periods before entering the Women Take the Floor exhibition, which focuses on overlooked and underrepresented female artists of the 20th century. There was a dedicated spot in the show where visitors could sit and write their thoughts. One note read, "This was odd, like me." And it struck me that people could see representation of themselves in this show and had the opportunity to engage. I loved being able to read their comments and see the ways in which Women Take the Floor impacted them. The show is closed right now due to coronavirus, but I'm looking forward to its reopening. Ultimately, as I was walking through the American Wing, I could see examples from various historical periods of what inclusion looks like. This is what we are striving towards. Okay, I only hope that as you take on this new role, that you, Rosa, will be able to bring your full self to this position and not just sit on the laurels of the title. These galleries and these museums have a funny way of losing their artistic culture. I'm trying to thread a needle here. Of losing their artistic culture to becoming just another corporation. And that's not what art should be. I'm of no illusion. Capitalism runs the art industry. like the monetary value that we put on some of these. Hey, I'm just an amateur art enthusiast here, but I'm looking at some of this stuff and I don't see the soul in it. I don't see the skill, the passion, the commitment, and some of the things that I see sell for millions of dollars. It's almost like sometimes it's an insult. Again, amateur art enthusiast. If you're able to bring your full self to this position, Rosa, you can help reveal those things from communities that's been that's been marginalized in this industry. Help them tell their stories, and it will be part of your story, part of your legacy. These institutions, as corporations, they'll create a position like this, no problem, and just put a label on it and give you a title and say, hey, boom, we did this, put out a news release and forget about it. But there's meaning that could happen here. You can bring meaning to this. So I don't know if you're listening, Rosa, but at least from the one article that they let you put out, well, from the one article that was written about this, they let you tell your story there, but it really did not speak a lot about diversity, really. It didn't speak about people of color, whether it's Latinx or Black. It didn't. Is it foreshadowing? I surely hope not. I surely hope you keep your foot on the gas, take this position, and hold them accountable to what they say they want to do. So, those were some news from the art world. Let's get back to our artist, Leonardo da Vinci. One of the most important and influential figures of the Renaissance was the painter, sculptor, architect, and engineer Leonardo da Vinci. A man often referred to as an artist who epitomized the Renaissance art. He is amongst the greatest painters in history, and with his unique powers of observation and competence as an illustrator, it allowed him to recreate the effects he saw in nature and added vigor to his portraits. Born in 1452 in the town of Vinci, Leonardo began his early artistic training in Florence, working at the workshop of the sculptor Andrea Verrocchio. There, he received a multifaceted training in painting, sculpting, and technical mechanical arts. Leo left Verrocchio's workshop in 1476 and worked independently in Florence until about 1481. Many historians and scholars regard him as the prime exemplar of the universal genius or Renaissance man, an individual of unquenchable curiosity and feverishly inventive imagination. And he's widely considered one of the most diversely talented individuals ever to have lived. According to art historian Helen Gardner, the scope and depth of his interests were without precedent in recorded history, and his mind and personality seemed to be almost superhuman, while the man himself mysterious and remote. Now, I wouldn't hit. He may have been considered mysterious and remote, but I wouldn't say that's how he, you know, moved through the world. His life was actually all about logic rather than mystery and empirical methods, and he used all this stuff in all his endeavors. It was rather unorthodox for his time. Da Vinci made a scientific study of light and shadow in nature to realize the objects that objects weren't necessarily composed of outlines. I remember when I first took a beginning figure drawing course, and The professor told me, oh, by the way, life doesn't have outlines, so I don't want to see any outlines. And I was like, it was like an epiphany. Like, duh, of course life doesn't have outlines. Until somebody, you know, literally says it to you, you just don't even think of those things, especially when we grew up with cartoons and animation and movies. You know, especially earlier on, you see there's an outline on on Simba. But, you know, he used this technique of, you know, without the outlines, that, you know, showing the world in the three-dimensional way that it really is. This technique is called chiaroscuro. Chiaroscuro. Okay. I'm not sure I'm pronouncing that right. But the realization and experimentation gave his paintings the soft, lifelike quality that made older works appear flat. Leo also understood that an object's color and detail changed as it retreated in the distance. Such a technique is called sfumato. This was first developed by Flemish and Venetian painters, but with Da Vinci's artist genius, it became a powerful tool that created atmosphere and depth. And that brings us to today's ekphrastic poem. It's actually not an original. It was written by Walter Pater. He was an academic, essayist, writer in the late 1800s. Late 1800s, folks, so you're going to hear some funky old school English. And he's describing none other than Mona Lisa. I'll give you a second to search for it in your browser. The presence that thus rose so strangely beside the waters is expressive of what is the ways of 1,000 years. 1,000 years men had come to desire. Hers is the head upon which all the ends of the world are come, and the eyelids are a little weary. A beauty wrought out from within upon the flesh, the deposit, little cell by cell, of strange thoughts and fantastic reveries and exquisite passions. Set it for a moment beside one of those white Greek goddesses or beautiful women of antiquity, and how would they be troubled by this beauty into which the soul with all its maladies has passed? All the thoughts and experience of the world have etched and molded there, in that which they have of power to refine and make expressive the outward form. The animalism of Greece, the lust of Rome, the reverie of the Middle Age with its spiritual ambition and imaginative love, the return of the pagan world, the sins of the Borgias. She is older than the rocks amongst which she sits like a vampire. She has been dead many times and learned the secrets of the grave, and has been a diver in the deep seas, and keeps their fallen day about her, and trafficked for strange webs with Eastern merchants, and as Leda was the mother of Helen of Troy, and as Saint Anne the mother of Mary. And all this has been to her but as the sound of lyres and flutes, and living only in the delicacy of which it has molded the changing lineaments and tinged the eyelids and the hands. The fancy of a perpetual life sweeping together 10,000 experiences is an old one, and modern thought has conceived the idea of humanity as wrought upon by and summing up in itself all modes of thought and life. Certainly, Lady Lisa might stand as the embodiment of the old fancy, the symbol of the modern idea. Leonardo was and is renowned primarily as a painter. Amongst his works, the Mona Lisa is the most famous and most parodied portrait in the world. The Last Supper, the most reproduced religious painting in the world of all time. Leo's drawings of the Vitruvian Man is also regarded as a cultural icon, being reproduced on items like the Euro coin, textbooks. I remember in middle school, my textbook had a the Vitruvian Man on the cover. You can find his that particular figure even on t-shirts. The Mona Lisa is one of the most valuable paintings in the world. It holds the Guinness World Record for highest known insurance valuation in history at about $100 million. That was in 1962. Today, that's like $600 million. Another painting by Leo Salvatore Mundi sold in 2017 for a new world record of, get this, $450.3 million at Christie's in New York. The highest price ever paid for any work of art, ever. In his final years, while living in France, he did little painting and mainly worked on his scientific studies and his treatises on painting. In April 1519, Leo devised a will and left the majority of his collection to his acclaimed pupil and companion, Francesco Melzi. He died later that year and was buried in Amboise. Leonardo remains amongst the world's most important figures in art history. However, it is important to note that his influence goes far beyond the drawings, that is. He has, you know, the scientific diagrams, technical studies, and in his notebooks. They're known his scientific writings are known to, and mechanical inventions were known to be centuries ahead of their time. The Museo Leonardino in Vinci, Italy, offers the broadest and most original collections of machines and models devoted to Leonardo's, you know, engineer interests. So if you're ever in Italy, check that spot out. There's the architect stuff and scientific theoretical projects that he was working on. For history on Renaissance technology in general, it's a great spot to take a tour. So, Leonardo da Vinci, folks, it's been fun sharing this art with you today. Thanks for joining me on this journey. Remember, you can find this episode and other episodes cataloged at darwindarko.com. That's it for today. Thanks for listening.